Welcome to Your 20-Minute Podcast with David Brower, where we do our best to give you useful information in 20 minutes or less. Now, here's your host, five-time Voice Arts Awards nominee, David Brower.
Thanks, Alan. This is David Brower with your 20-Minute Podcast. Our special guest today from Santa Rosa, California, is Dr. Clue, a.k.a. Dave Blum. Hey, Doctor, or Dave, whichever you prefer, welcome to the show. Glad you're here.
Thanks, David. Great to be here.
You bet. You've got a BA in English from Pomona College. You're a certified professional coach. You've taught English in Japan, and you've been a puzzle and game nerd your whole life, which leads you to the creation of Dr. Clue Treasure Hunts. Tell us about that.
Well, I made a decision at a certain point. I was in my early 30s, and I decided I wanted to start a business that would sum up all of my main interests, because otherwise you're not really having fun and enjoying your life. So I looked at what I had done and said, okay, I really like working with groups. Mm-hmm. I had been a English teacher in Japan. I'd been an RA in college. I'd been a tour guide. So I love that group dynamic. I really love traveling and showing people the cool things that I discover. Mm-hmm. And of course, as you mentioned, I was a puzzle and game nerd. I love crossword puzzles and every kind of game. I love Sudokus. And so I thought, you know, game night is my favorite thing. What if I tried to, if I combined all three of my interests? And that's how Dr. Clue was born. And
I'll so be
it was
darn.
Somewhat, it was somewhat intentional. Of course, I didn't believe it would ever work, but you know,
that's the payoff. That's the payoff, though, right?
The idea and say, yeah, well, it's like anything. You come up with the idea and say, okay, let's put this out into the world and, you know, literally see who salutes. And if it doesn't work, it's still a fun activity and I'll enjoy it. But if people are as enthusiastic about it as I am, and it fits a gap or a need,
right?
You know, let's go with it. So
I just
pointed my missile in that direction to see what would happen. And remarkably, it has continued for 24 years now.
That is so cool. So you use your skill set, your three skill sets, I guess, as a treasure hunt master, they say. You're a team building trainer, really, an entrepreneur, right? You help people, companies build teams in a unique way,
exactly.
I'm assuming.
That's the idea, is that, you know, how much are people really going to learn about team building if they sit in a workshop and watch PowerPoint about it?
Yep.
Not very much. Or if they're, and even if you're in the office, and let's say you have a training room, and you, even if you have team building activities in the office, there's still the feeling of hierarchy. There's still a feeling of status. There's still, and of course, all the distractions. So our feeling is that people really build teamwork and camaraderie and rapport when they get away from the office, when they get away from all those distractions and all of the built-in hierarchies, and can let their hair down. And so they think, oh, great, this is just going to be a fun activity. And then they're surprised at all of the value add that comes with it.
That is so fascinating to me. I hadn't read your bio yet. It was about a week ago, and my wife and I were over at our dear friend's house, who are avid gamers. I mean, they play any kind of board game, card game, you name it. They've got trunks full of stuff, right? So we get done with dinner, and they pull out this game that I've never heard of before, and it was the most fun. It took our brains off every distraction, every thought other than just laughing and playing the game. So I get the basic of what you're talking about. Makes a lot of sense to me.
Well, you know, there's been studies, and you've probably heard this, that they took a couple of people who didn't know each other, and they hooked them up to various devices to try and figure out what their stress level was and what their level of connection was. And then they hooked the people up and they said, okay, now we're going to have to play a game. And they actually did GarageBand. And they did that for 20 minutes.
Oh, my
gosh.
After
20 minutes of playing GarageBand, they had the same level of connection and the same level of sort of connected energy as best friends. So in 20 minutes, they went from not knowing each other to having that same connection just by playing a game.
And that's unbelievable. Oh, my gosh. That's like, I mean, people are looking for the silver bullet on different things in life and business and all that kind of thing. And this sounds like that. I mean, how fun and how interesting and how just let your hair down. Let's play a game. Oh, we're best friends in 20 minutes. My goodness.
Yeah. But you know, the thing is, it has to be done in the right way.
Sure.
There are, you know, you've probably had the experience of going to a game night and this person is arguing or bickering with that person. I had that experience as a kid. When I was 13 years old, I said, I'm going to learn how to play bridge because my mom and dad were bridge players. And so I read a book and I learned a little bit. And then I went down to my mom's bridge club and all of the adults were getting angry and peevish at me for how slow I was because I was learning. Right. And I left there and they were mean to each other. And I said, I don't want any part of this.
Right.
And so games can bring out the best in people or they can bring out the worst in people. So the trick is to create a structure and to frame it in such a way where it brings out people's best.
And does the atmosphere, does the ambiance, does the room, does the layout, do all those kinds of things play into how you set this up?
All of them are important. Absolutely. Yeah, you really want to set it up in a way. And my interest really is in collaborative games. Have you heard of those?
Sure.
Yeah. You know, it's a new trend. You know, in the past it was, you know, Monopoly and all these various things, which are, you know, Risk, which are highly competitive. But there's a whole new genre of games now where people work together as a team. They leverage the skills and knowledge. They delegate appropriately, and they're really competing against either a big bad of some sort or a milestone that they're trying to achieve. But they're not necessarily pitted against each other in a cutthroat struggle, because I think we have enough of that at work.
Isn't that the truth? So what I've heard of that term only by term. What kind of games or names of games or style of games might somebody recognize or have heard of?
Well, if you're into board games, there are a lot of them. The ones that I really like, there's a fantastic game called Desert Island.
Okay.
And it also, there's another one that is a sequel to it, which is called something like Forbidden Desert, I think.
Okay.
But my favorite is a game called Pandemic, which is a game where you are researchers for the CDC. You're trying to cure diseases across the globe.
Mm-hmm.
But meanwhile, these incredible outbreaks are happening. So a lot of these games have a positive outcome you're trying to achieve, which is, you know, get the treasure or solve disease in the world. But then there's also this negative thing that you're trying to prevent happening, which is, you know, death, destruction, a world outbreak. And so there's this dynamic between prevent the bad thing while trying to achieve the good thing. What's lovely about all these games is that each person is given sort of secret powers, secret skills. And so the goal of it is everyone discusses together what is our next move, and should we use that person's secret power now, or should we use it later? There's usually some passing of resources, so you have to always be thinking about how can we efficiently pass the resources, the right person gets it at the right time. So it's kind of a group discussion where everyone wins together or everyone loses together.
So when you reach out to a company or a company reaches out to you, and I guess that's the question, how do they find you or begin the discussion with you?
Well, of course I do quite a bit of marketing. I have a newsletter that I send out every 2 weeks where I send out a clue puzzle and it leads to somewhere interesting in the world. So it's kind of an online treasure hunt every couple of weeks. But then a lot of it is people find me on my website, which is drclue.com, drclue.com. So they find me on the web, and usually they're looking for a specific location.
So really?
Let's say that you're in Charleston, South Carolina, and you're thinking, we'd really like to have a team building program in Charleston. And so they would actually type in either team building Charleston or scavenger hunt if they know what they want to do, scavenger hunt, treasure hunt, Charleston. And our specific page for that area would pop up, and they say, oh, look, there's something here already. And then they say, hey, we want to do this. Great. We'll meet them on site, like a field trip, and they get to do a site-specific treasure hunt in that area of their choice.
Oh, my. That's brilliant.
So we have about 150 different parks, neighborhoods, and museums on our site where we have scouted out treasure hunts.
Yeah.
And then people say, hey, that we want to do that one. And we say, great, meet us there. And then we do the program.
My gosh. So when you, I'm baffled by that. Fascinated by that is a better word. So when they do that search, I'm just looking on your site. Actually, I have some kids that live in Portland. So here's a Portland corporate team building scavenger hunt.
Yeah.
Several opportunities in the Northwest. And so Portland downtown, Portland OMSI Museum, I know where both of those are. Mm-hmm. That's fascinating how easy it is to find something, hopefully, in your own backyard, like Banff, Alberta, Canada. There's Vancouver. There's the Museum of Anthropology in Vancouver, Seattle. My gosh, this is and you've been building this for 14 years?
24.
24, hello.
So in 24 years, you have a chance to visit a lot of locations.
And we sure do.
Locations in all up and down the West Coast, like you mentioned, but also all across North America. Uh-huh. We've also done programs in Paris and in Geneva and in Madrid and in Dubai, in London, in Israel. So we've done programs all across the world. And it inevitably is either, hey, we see you have that location. We have a group coming there. We really want to do that hunt. Mm-hmm. Or we're having a meeting in so-and-so location. Can you come out and create it for us? And
then, oh my gosh.
So sometimes it's a combination of something that is already exists and then also proactive. A lot of times we'll just create a hunt in a location because we want to have a hunt there. But then also people ask for something customized. Like we're currently doing hunts for the St. Louis Cardinals and the New York Yankees. And they basically said, we want something at our stadium. Like, fantastic. Let's
fantastic is right. So I'm assuming, and this may not be a fair assumption, but I would think with the success you've had and the way people find you and talk about you, word of mouth for this has to be referrals, has to be over the top.
That's, of course, the holy grail or
right?
You know, the treasure at the end of the rainbow for every small business. People to spread the word.
That's your ultimate scavenger hunt, right?
That is the ultimate scavenger hunt. And after every program, I ask for a testimonial, and I say that is a treasure chest for us.
Perfect.
It's your positive feedback.
Perfect. On the website, on one of the links, it says, three reasons to choose Dr. Clue for your next event. We overcome employee unfamiliarity, which you just talked about. We release employee stress, which is invaluable. I don't care how big or how small the company is. We do it in a fun, structured way for maximum impact, which you referred to. And Dr. Clue is not really a scavenger hunt company at all. We release stress and build trust relationships that your company needs to be successful. That is the key sentence right there that anybody that runs a business would love to have that silver bullet.
Indeed. Yeah, there's a lot of stress going around. And I'd say most of the people who come to us, the first thing they say is, we've been going through a stressful time, mm-hmm. and we really want to do something fun for our group. So it doesn't have to be all heavy and serious with metrics all that. A lot of times we just want to do something fun away from the office to release the stress and to reward people for good work done.
Yeah.
There's also, I think, there's more to it than that.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly a lot of it is that people don't know each other, you know,
correct.
Particularly in our current virtual workplaces where people are geographically dispersed.
Right.
You know, if they're coming together, you know, you've got people working at home and they're not very connected with the people back in the office. And then you've got people coming in from for national sales meetings and, you know, they just don't know each other. And how can you expect to do your best work when you don't, know, like, and trust? So,
well, that's
right. This is a great way. So usually people will divide up the teams so that every team has broken the cliques. Every team is people who don't know each other very well, and they're going to have a chance to really sit down and get to know each other, get to see how they work, get to see each other's personality in good times, but also under stress. And they're really hopefully going to go through the whole gauntlet together. And when it's done, they're going to look at each other and say, I know you better. You know, I've got a good sense of you, and I'd be willing to get on the phone and share information with you in the future. I'd be willing to get on the phone and ask for help. And that's really what we're trying to break down.
Absolutely right. And the know, like, trust thing, you hear that periodically from people trying to convince businesses that this is what you need to get new business. You know, they need to know, like, and trust you. And it makes all the sense in the world with team building, because especially like you say, where the employees are often dispersed, they don't know a mustache from a bootleg, you know, and it's makes all the sense. Because then when you connect with somebody and then later on you talk to them on the phone, email, whatever, you have that physical, you have that facial recognition, for lack of a better term, that makes the process go much more smoothly because there's much more trust, right?
You know, people keep asking me, can you do a virtual team building? Because we've got people from all different offices. Can we do it virtually? And I have tried and tried, and I haven't been satisfied with the results.
Yeah.
It still is something about being physically in the room for human beings and seeing the gestures and the facial expressions and the body language. It still seems to be essential for really building trust.
Makes sense. One of my favorite classes, this was decades ago, one of my favorite classes in college was body language. And it was like, oh my God. And so ever since then, you know, like you just brought it up, and my kids bring it up, and my wife brings it up, and you know, there's so much that you can learn from body language, and that makes all the sense in the world what you're saying, because you can see maybe a taste of body language on a 24-inch screen, but you're certainly not going to feel it and get the full meaning of it.
I think that trust is such an interesting thing, and it's bandied around that term. A lot of people don't know what it means. In fact, trust can be broken down into a few components.
Okay.
Yeah. One of them is competency.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning that, you know, if you are good at your job, you will get some trust. And if you're, you know, if you don't pay attention to the details, you're not. So you have to be competent.
Yep.
You also have to be reliable. That means you have to do what you say you're going to do.
There you go.
And people, and on our programs, this is one of the things we talk about, is people will say, okay, I'm going to be your point person for this type of challenge. Mm-hmm. I'm going to be the person for this type of puzzle, this type of thing. And then they have to actually do what they say they're going to do and deliver and actually solve that challenge. So so that's really important.
Yeah.
There's another aspect of sincerity is really important. Meaning,
sure.
You know, you can't lie. You know,
right.
You just can't do it. You know, as soon as you do that, trust is out the window.
Yeah.
I think fairness is very, very important. People are remarkably sensitive when things don't seem fair.
Yeah.
So if you're a leader, you have to be extremely diligent about being fair. But the most important thing that actually sort of overlays all of them is caring.
And people
And people don't really realize this, because even if you are occasionally, you slip up and you do a little unreliable, or you make a little white lie or whatever it is, and you mess up a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
If you are caring, people will eventually forgive you, and you can rebuild trust. And caring means that you think about the other people. If you're a manager, you're thinking about their career and maybe even sacrificing your own needs in order to think about the other person's career progress, but also their personal life. You're putting yourself in their shoes. That caring will overcome all the other ones. It's the most important, and it's one that's very often neglected.
I love that, because oftentimes, and I do this myself, and we only have a couple of minutes, but I often do this myself. I'm a big fan of authenticity and integrity. But what I like about adding caring to that trifecta, if you will, is it brings in a much more emotional piece of the equation, because the emotion, the caring, I got goosebumps when you're talking about that, man. That's crazy smart. Yeah, I love it.
Yeah. I mean, authenticity and transparency are really reliable. But sometimes people use them as a crutch. Like they'll say rude things. They'll say really rude things and say, hey, I'm just being real here. Well, you're being a real jerk.
I got your real right here, buddy.
How about being caring?
That's right. Hey, folks, you want to learn more, and you do. You got to check out Dr. Clue. That's DR.CLUE. Dr. Clue on the website, though, is one word, DRCLUE.com. Solving the puzzle of teamwork. There's what to expect, the hunt locations, charity programs, all types of hunt, even do-it-yourself hunt kits. It's a fabulous, fabulous program. I am so impressed, Dave, and congratulations on your many successes, and here's to 24 more years, man.
Thank you so much, David. It's been a real pleasure.
Listen to your 20-minute podcast with David Brower on the go. Downloads are available on YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, iTunes, iHeartRadio, Spotify, any podcast app, and on our website at davidbrowervo.com/your20-minute podcast. Until next time, thank you for listening.